Hello friends, welcome to One Academy. Let's crack NEET PG. I'm Dr. Shonali Chandra, and in today's session, we will be talking about endometriosis and its consequences. I've highlighted my reference code here, that is SHONALI. So if you take a plus subscription, you can use this code to avail a 10% discount on your subscription package. An Academy is India's largest learning platform. The advantages of taking a plus subscription is that it will give you access to unlimited live and recorded sessions from India's best educators. You'll get daily live classes where you can chat with your educator, interact, ask your doubts and queries, get them solved there and then. So it's like a live classroom experience. The courses are structured keeping in line with the latest NEET PG syllabus. There are also live tests and quizzes which will help you evaluate your preparation along the way. And one subscription, most importantly, gives unlimited access. You can watch all the live sessions from all of the faculties on the platform. And even if you miss out on the live sessions, you can always go back and watch the recorded versions from the comfort of your own devices. Top educators are associated with the platform, Dr. Nikita Nanwani, Dr. Mohammad Azam, Dr. Preeti Sharma, Dr. Devesh Mishra sir for pathology. And all 19 subjects which we need to prepare are covered on the platform. And every now and then, comprehensive batch courses, as well as short duration, concise crash courses, they keep getting launched. So you can check out the ongoing courses in the platform as well. And as far as the subscription packages go, there are various duration packages depending upon your need and requirement. You can choose any one of them. There is a 3 months subscription package, 6 months subscription package, 12 month or 24 months. So if you ask me, for those of you who are targeting the next year mid-year exams, they can take the 12 month subscription because it will give you ample time to go through all the sessions and even give you enough time in the end to revise as well, and that's very important. And it turns out to be more economical in the long run also, ₹2,083 per month. And for those of you who want a slower pace of preparation, right, you are in your third year or final year, and of course you're juggling hospital duties and schedules and clinics along with, so you can take the 24-month subscription. It will turn out to be far more economical in the longer run, ₹1,250 per month. And if you subscribe using my code, that is SHONALI, then you can avail a 10% discount on whatever subscription package that you decide to choose from. So coming back to the session at hand for today, we are going to talk about endometriosis and its consequences. Welcome, Ehsan, Tahira, Uja, Osborne. Hello, everybody. So before I want to start the discussion of infertility, I wanted to focus on one particular condition, which is endometriosis. It's a chronic condition affecting the reproductive age group women, and it affects a woman in ways more than one. It leads to serious consequences. It can be mild in clinical presentation as well, or sometimes can lead to serious consequences like infertility. And it affects the fertility also in ways more than one. So I want to talk about the pathology behind endometriosis. I want to talk about the clinical presentation. I want to talk about how to make a diagnosis of endometriosis. And once the diagnosis is made, what can be done? And in the end, I will also take up a few questions which can be asked in the NEET PG examinations pertaining to this topic. So let's begin. What is endometriosis? Now, endometriosis is a condition where the endometrial glands and stroma, they are located outside the uterus as well. Now, that's something that is abnormal because the normal location of the endometrium is inside the uterine cavity, right? And if their endometrial glands and stroma are also present outside the uterus, where outside the uterus? In the pelvis. And there are some various rare locations of endometriosis also where it has been documented and seen. So it can be anywhere in the body. Most importantly and most commonly, it is in the pelvis itself. Now, this condition is predominantly seen in the reproductive age group women. So women suffering from endometriosis are usually in their mid-20s, late-20s and 30s and 40s. So that's the time span when this endometriosis becomes problematic. It's an estrogen dependent condition, and that is self-explanatory because obviously that's why it is seen most commonly in the reproductive age group. The endometrial glands and stroma, which are located outside the uterus, they also respond to hormonal stimulus and they also respond to estrogen and they grow in response to this estrogen. And that is another reason why this, lesions of endometriosis, they regress during pregnancy and after menopause. Now, during pregnancy, what happens is that there is a lot of progesterone that is coming from the placenta, right? So this progesterone causes a regression of these endometriotic deposits because progesterone, as we have seen, is the stabilizing influence over the effects of estrogen. So progesterone causes decidualization of these endometriotic deposits, and therefore it has been seen to regress during pregnancy as well. And after menopause, when the ovaries have stopped functioning, then the hormone production from the ovaries has declined considerably and eventually stopped, then the endometriotic deposits, they also regress after menopause. And the other important thing is that there is sometimes seen that there is a genetic predisposition also pertaining to endometriosis, and one of the genes that has been implicated is a KRAS gene mutation, and therefore it has been seen that women who have family history of endometriosis, they tend to suffer more from endometriosis, like first degree relatives, like sisters and mothers affected with endometriosis, they tend to have endometriosis as well, and the risk is increased to 7 times. Now, the general population prevalence of endometriosis is somewhere about 10% in the reproductive age group women, and if there's a first degree relative who has endometriosis, then the risk is increased 7 times. Now, Subhash, you want to know, endometrial carcinoma 2 is estrogen dependent? Yes, it is. Endometrial carcinoma 2 is estrogen dependent. And some histological types of endometrial carcinoma, not all. The endometrial carcinoma is which has seen to be typically estrogen dependent. Okay, now moving ahead about endometriosis, let's talk about what causes endometriosis in the first place. Now, there are various theories which are given as to how endometriosis develop. How is it that this endometrium has landed outside the uterus? How is it all brought about? And one of the theories which has been given for the first time, so way back this theory was given, this was the initial theory, right? This is also the most accepted theory, is called as the Samson theory of retrograde menstruation and implantation. So on this NEET PG people, they ask you a direct question, what is the most common accepted theory? It's the Samson theory of retrograde menstruation and implantation. So it is self-explanatory if you remember these words. Retrograde menstruation, normally in menstruation, the menses are going to flow outwards, right? Now, this is retrograde menstruation. Some endometrial tissue by way of retrograde menstruation can go out of the tubes and enter the pelvis, right? And there, when those deposits land in the pelvis, they are going to implant themselves and then they are going to proliferate, right? So it was seen that retrograde menstruation has been seen not in all the women with endometriosis, but in majority of the women with endometriosis. So they said that maybe there is some other theory that is explaining the genesis of endometriosis. So they believe that, yes, sometimes there is immune dysregulation also. So there is an immune-mediated theory as well to explain that not all women with retrograde menstruation go on to develop endometriosis, but if the woman has immune-mediated changes in the body, then it could lead to endometriosis, and these deposits can proliferate in that situation. Another theory that has been often cited is as the coelomic metaplasia theory, right? So it is believed that not a single theory operates. It's mostly a combination of all of these factors which leads to the development of endometriosis. But yes, one of the most accepted theories is this retrograde menstruation and implantation. And it also helps to explain the most common sites of endometriosis. So if there is retrograde implantation, you can very well understand that these deposits, they land first of all in the ovary. After that, they also drop down and they land into the pouch of Douglas. This is the pouch of Douglas. This is the peritoneal covering here, which is called as the pouch of Douglas. They can also land on these uterosacral ligaments and form deposits there. So these are the common sites. These are the most common sites of endometriotic deposits, which are ovary. All right, a direct question has been asked in PG examination. What is the most common site? Ovary. Then the pouch of Douglas, the peritoneum covering the pouch of Douglas, and then the uterosacral ligaments, right? And it has also been seen that the chances of having retrograde menstruation are going to increase if there are Mullerian anomalies. Supposing there was a transverse vaginal septum, then instead of forward flow, there's going to be retrograde menstruation. Sometimes there can be a unicorn weight uterus with a rudimentary horn, right? So in all of these situations, wherever there are Mullerian anomalies, they have more tendency of developing endometriosis. So it is also explained, this phenomena, that the endometriosis is more common in women with Mullerian anomalies is also explained by this theory of retrograde menstruation and implantation. Now, that's not all. These are not all the theories. It has been seen that there are certain very rare sites of endometriosis as well. Like, endometriosis has also been seen at scar sites. So how did it happen to come on scar sites? Now, what scar sites I'm talking about? The common scar sites are the epigeotomy scar site or a cesarean scar site. So it could be on the abdominal incision of the cesarean section as well. So it has been seen that sometimes there can be direct implantation, and this question again was asked in the NEET PG examination, that what explains the genesis of endometriosis in the scar sites. It could be a cesarean section scar, it could be an epigeotomy scar, and the theory is direct implantation theory. Direct implantation theory. Now I can explain this to you in a way that, like, I have seen a case in my time where we did a cesarean section for a woman, absolutely uncomplicated, no problem, nothing. And then when her scar healed, you know, in the postpartum period, she came back saying that she feels some nodularity in her incision site, just at the angle of the incision site. And she says that that it doesn't heal. There's just a nodularity there. And sometimes it got infected and then it started extruding pus also. We gave her antibiotics, but the nodularity did not settle down at all. And when she developed menses after 3 months, when she started menstruating after 3 months, there was bleeding seen from this nodularity which was present at her abdominal scar site. We excised that lesion, we send it for histopathology, and the histopathology told us that it is endometriotic tissue. So how did the endometriosis land there? Maybe we gave the incision, right? And we've used the scalpel, we use the sutures. So along those tracks, direct implantation theory explains the genesis of scar site endometriosis. Then there are other rare sites like the pleura and lungs. Not very frequent, these are rare sites, okay? So it has been seen that the endometriotic deposits can move into the pleura and lungs by this hematogenous spread to the nose as well. It can lead to spread of endometriotic deposits and tissues into the nose via the direct hematogenous spread, and that can lead to situations where a woman could complain of a bleeding from the nose during the time of menses, or hemoptysis, you know, bleeding in the cough with during the time of menses, or pleural pain also. But these are rare occurrences, but yes, they have been documented in clinical history as well. So this is about the genesis of endometriosis. Now let's talk about what the endometriosis does, what it does. So the another important point that I also wanted to emphasize on, what is the most common extragenital site? So this is again a direct question that has been asked in the exams, that endometriosis can involve any of the structures present inside the pelvis, all right? And mostly it is seen as peritoneal deposits, and the most common extragenital site is the sigmoid colon. So please remember these direct one-liner pointers. Okay. Now talking about how endometriosis affects the woman. So this is a laparoscopic view of a normal pelvis. Look how shiny, glistening the peritoneum is. Look how freely the tubes move. Look how freely the ovaries are hanging. Look at this pouch of Douglas, absolutely clear and clean. I'm looking from the umbilicus, you know, from that port, from that umbilical port. I'm having a look down into the pelvis, and it's all clear, absolutely sheen and shiny and everything. Now these endometriotic deposits, which are present in the pelvis, these deposits each month, they are going to bleed. Under hormonal influence, they are also going to bleed. When bleeding will happen in these spaces inside the peritoneum, over the peritoneal surfaces, over these deposits, ultimately it is going to lead to a release of inflammatory mediators. It is going to lead to a fibrosis eventually, because see, menstrual blood flow from the uterine cavity has an outlet, right? But this bleeding here in the deposits has no outlet. So it is going to keep getting collected here and induce inflammatory and fibrotic changes inside the peritoneum, and this is what the peritoneum of a woman affected with endometriosis would look like. Look at this figure here on the left. On the left, we are seeing brown colored deposits. So look at these brownish, darkish, ashen gray deposits here. And can you see? I cannot see where the tubes are. I cannot see where the ovaries are. They are all adhered to each other. There's all this fibrosis that is present inside the pelvis, right? So I can see these powder burnt deposits. They're called as powder burnt deposits. Old deposits tend to look powder burnt in appearance, and there can be fresh deposits also inside the pelvis. So look at this. This is the ovary, this is the tube here, and can you see here, it feels as if a curtain has been applied, a whitish film, you know, flimsy curtain has been applied over the ovaries. So these are the adhesions. These adhesions can be severe, these adhesions can be thick, or they can be flimsy as well. And look at all these deposits here. These deposits are not empty. These are deposits which are filled with, these are cystic deposits which are filled with peritoneal fluid. That peritoneal fluid is rich in inflammatory mediators. That peritoneal fluid can also be collecting blood. So look at this bluish deposits because of the collection of blood inside these deposits. So these bluish black deposits are the fresh deposits which can be seen inside the pelvis. And appreciate the difference here. I cannot see where the pouch of Douglas is. I cannot see deep within the pouch of Douglas. It's all adhered. Everything seems to be adhered to the posterior surface of the uterus. The gut can also come and adhere to the posterior surface of the uterus or in the pouch of Douglas. So this is how endometriosis slowly, progressively, over a period of years is going to affect a woman. It is going to wreak havoc inside the pelvis until unless it is treated, right? So in the mildest forms, they can cause adhesions, distorted anatomy completely. You cannot make out where the tubes and ovaries are. Are these inflammatory mediators that are released in these deposits, they cause local peritoneal inflammation, bleeding in these implants. These implants can invade and burrow into the peritoneum, and all of this is going to cause what? pain, all of this is going to cause pain, severe pain, right? And chronic pelvic pain is one of the manifestations of endometriosis. Now, in the mildest forms, there might be very few of such deposits, or there could just be deposits in the ovaries. What are these called as? These, you can see these brownish deposits in the ovaries. The ovaries are enlarged. They have collection of cysts inside them. These cysts are filled with old clotted blood. These cysts are filled with hemosiderin, right? And that is why they look this chocolate brown in appearance. They inside them, it is this brownish colored fluid that is collected, right? And that is rich in hemosiderin and old clotted blood. So that is called as endometrioma or a chocolate cyst. So these ovarian cysts, which are seen with endometriosis, they are called as chocolate cysts or endometrioma. All right. Now, this is what happens inside the pelvis in a woman suffering from endometriosis. So what is the clinical presentation? Now, the clinical presentation is going to be reflective of the pathological processes that are taking place. So a woman complains of chronic pelvic pain. She can also complain of dysmenorrhea. Okay, there might not be a chronic on a regular basis of pelvic pain, but there could be severe congestive dysmenorrhea. This dysmenorrhea is going to be severe and congestive, not the usual spasmodic dysmenorrhea that all women have. She will complain of pain during menses, which occurs a couple of days before the actual bleeding happens, and the pain lasts for the entire duration of the menstrual cycle and is very, very severe. Dyspareunia, painful intercourse, is another clinical presentation that can happen. So if the deposits are peculiarly present over the uterosacral ligaments, okay, if the deposits are present peculiarly over the uterosacral ligaments and the pouch of Douglas, then on sexual intercourse, these deposits are going to get irritated and they can cause severe dyspareunia, painful intercourse as well. And one thing to note here, and this question is asked in the NEET PG exam as well, that what will determine the severity of the pain, right? Obviously, the more severely that the architecture in the pelvis is distorted, the more severe the adhesions, there is going to be more pain which will be there in the woman. Apart from that, the peritoneal deposits which are invading the peritoneal, they will invade the surrounding nerves as well, irritate those nerves, and that causes severe pain. So the severity of pain is directly proportional to the depth of invasion. So depending upon how deeply invasive these endometriotic deposits are, the severity of pain is going to be affected. So more deeply invasive endometriosis, more is the severity of pain. Apart from this, you can see here that there is going to be infertility in these women. Infertility is a major consequence or a major life-changing consequence of endometriosis. Sometimes there can be a pelvic mass in the when the ovaries are enlarged because of ovarian cyst formation, right? So pelvic mass can also be there. This is an ovarian cyst which can be there in a case of endometriosis, right? Now, endometriosis is typically more commonly seen in nulliparous women. Obviously, there's underlying infertility also, right? And more so because pregnancy has been seen to have a protective effect and a regressive effect. And that's why it is easier to understand that, yes, indeed, endometriosis is more commonly seen in the nulliparous woman. And a direct question that is asked in exams is, what is the most common clinical presentation out of all these complications, right? So the most common clinical presentation is pain and then infertility. So most of the women are going to suffer from some or other kind of pain. So pain is the most common clinical presentation, followed by infertility. So this is the most common clinical presentation. Endometriosis is due to distorted ovaries, Subhash. Endometriosis is not due to distorted ovaries, but endometriosis leads to fibrosis in that area and it leads to distorted architecture inside the pelvis. All right. Now, moving ahead, what are the reasons for infertility? Now, I told you that endometriosis contributes to infertility in ways more than one. Now, in this particular situation where the anatomy is absolutely distorted, so you see the tubes and the ovaries, the egg is going to get released, right? And that is captured by the tubes. This is the fimbriel end of the tube. That egg has to be captured, ovum capture that is called, right? Now, if the architecture is distorted and the tubes are not free to move around the ovaries, the tubes are stuck, right? The fimbriel end of the tube is tilted behind. So this distorted architecture affects the action of the tube, at the functioning of the tube it affects, right? All this distorted anatomy and architecture is going to interfere with conception, interfere with ovum release and capture, right? So this is one of the reasons for infertility in this woman. Now, if I tell you, let's look at this case here. In this case, the tubes are otherwise free, the tubes are otherwise okay, but there are endometriotic deposits inside the ovary. So of course, you might say that there has to be some other reason also contributing to infertility. Now, these endometriotic deposits which are present inside the ovary, they are rich in inflammatory mediators. What do you think these inflammatory mediators do to the growing follicles inside the ovary? They are going to naturally affect the follicular growth as well, right? So the reasons for infertility are more than one. Distorted tubal anatomy, decreased tubo-ovarian motility, defective follicular development, all right, all those inflammatory mediators, these inflammatory mediators might not just be confined to the pelvis itself. By way of tubes, they can get inside the tubes also. These inflammatory mediators might seep in inside the tubes, reach the uterine cavity also. And that is from where the sperms are gaining access into the tubes, right? So it creates a toxic environment for sperms as well. So it also interferes with fertilization, mind you. So you see how endometriosis leads to infertility in ways more than one. All right. So if I ask you, is endometriosis associated with anovulation? Yes, endometriosis is associated with anovulation as well, because these inflammatory mediators which are released from these deposits, they lead to defective follicular development. And if the follicle is not going to develop properly, then it can lead to failure of ovulation as well, right? The other important thing to notice that sometimes what happens is that there can be mild endometriotic deposits only, mild or minimal endometriotic deposits only, which are not clinically identifiable based on history or clinical examination, and the woman could be labeled as unexplained infertility. You might find that a viable explanation for infertility is there, but even in those cases, about 40-50% of women are found eventually to be suffering from endometriosis. So very, very important point, question asked in exams, the prevalence of endometriosis in unexplained infertility is 40-50%. So based upon clinical history, examination and the initial tests, we feel that there is no explanation for the infertility. But when we dig in deeper, maybe when we go inside the pelvis and have a look, we find evidence of endometriosis. So the prevalence of endometriosis in unexplained infertility is as high as 40-50%. And this is a direct question that is asked in exam. Another important point to remember, please remember that endometriosis is also associated with anovulation, right? And please also remember that endometriosis does not cause damage to the insides of the tube. Okay, all this damage is happening on the outside of the tube. There is no damage to the inside of the tubes, right? So the tubal blockage is something that usually does not happen. So usually there is no tubal blockage because of endometriosis, right? So tubes are not blocked. The anatomy is distorted from the outside, right? So inside there is no tubal blockage usually in a case of endometriosis, all right? Now let's get ahead further and try to make the diagnosis of endometriosis. The diagnosis is based on relevant clinical history, right? So chronic pelvic pain, dyspareunia, dysmenorrhea, physical examination. Now you can understand that in case of mild endometriotic deposits where inside the pelvis there's just fibrosis and scarring that is taking place and these deposits are very small, then the physical examination may be normal. When we do a per-speculum examination or a per-vaginal examination, we might not find nothing, right? So the per-vaginal examination or per-speculum examination may be normal as well, or there could be tenderness, or there could be tenderness on per-vaginal examination. All right, so tenderness could be there, right? There could be a nodularity which is felt in the pouch of Douglas. We do a per-vaginal examination, okay? When we are putting our fingers inside the vagina and we are going into the posterior vaginal fornix, that is where the uterosacrals can be palpated. So that is where the pouch of Douglas can be palpated. So you can feel for a nodularity there. This nodularity is going to be tender to touch. There can be a fixed retroverted uterus. So let me show you this diagram here. So this is the vagina, this is the bladder here. Normally this is going to be the position of the uterus, okay, antiverted. And if I find that the uterus, instead of being antiverted, is placed like this, this is what we call as retroverted. If I find fixed retroversion of the uterus on clinical examination, that means something is pulling this uterus back. Something is pulling this uterus back. And that is the reason. Maybe, what is it pointing towards? Maybe there are adhesions here that are pulling the uterus back, that have made the uterus retroverted instead of the normal antiverted position. So this will raise the suspicion, these physical findings like nodularity in the pouch of Douglas. This is the pouch of Douglas here. This is the pouch of Douglas here. These are the uterosacrals. So we are doing a PV examination from here. We are putting our fingers inside the posterior vaginal fornix and we can feel for those nodularities, you know. So that will raise the suspicion of endometriosis, all right. And there could be an adnexal mass also. If there are endometriotic cysts in the ovary, then there could be an adnexal mass also. Ultrasound will not show these fibrosis and deposits. Ultrasound is not going to show these fibrosis and deposits if these deposits are very, very small. So ultrasound is more important for the diagnosis of endometriotic cyst per se. Cysts can definitely be seen on ultrasound. And this is the appearance of an endometriotic cyst. It is a very classic ground glass appearance of the endometrioma. So this is the endometriotic cyst because it contains all that clotted blood and all that hemosiderin laden deposits there. So it gives a classic ground glass appearance of the endometrioma. However, the definitive diagnosis of endometriosis can be made by question asked in NEET PG examination. Definite diagnosis can be made by laparoscopy, right? So all before this, the slides that I showed you, they were the laparoscopic pictures of endometriosis, right? So we go inside, have a look, find those deposits, take a biopsy from those deposits, send it for histopathology. The histopathology pathologist tells us that these deposits are containing endometriotic glands and stroma, right? So laparoscopy, ideally with histopathological confirmation. If the pathologist says, no, I don't find any endometrioma, does that mean that the diagnosis of endometriosis cannot be made? No, even then laparoscopy by itself is also pretty clear for to make the diagnosis of endometriosis. So classic visible appearance on laparoscopy is enough to make the diagnosis. If we get the histopathological confirmation, well and good. If we don't, even then a classic appearance on laparoscopy is good enough to make the diagnosis. So what is the gold standard for diagnosis of endometriosis? Question asked in NEET PG. It is laparoscopy. It is laparoscopy, which is the gold standard investigation for diagnosis endometriosis, right? Mariam, what is the endometrial tissue is present inside the tubes? It's generally not present inside the tubes. That's what I'm trying to tell you. It's generally not present inside the tubes. The insides of the tubes are usually normal. Okay? That's why usually no tubal blockage. Now, what about the treatment of endometriosis? The treatment of endometriosis will be divided into two aspects. One is the treatment of pain, and the other is going to be the treatment of infertility. Because most of the treatments of pain that we used, and we will see, they in turn induce amenorrhea. Okay, so treatment of pain unfortunately cannot go hand in hand with treatment of infertility. That's why two separate arms of treatment. So let's talk about the treatment of pain first. The treatment of pain, we can start with the medical treatment of pain, obviously. All right, and then we can also use the surgical treatment for pain. We do start with the medical treatment first. Now, what are the drugs that can be used for the medical treatment of pain in a case of endometriosis? These are the list of drugs with the NEET PG aspirants need to remember. So if it's a mild pain, if it's mild dysmenorrhea, you can obviously go ahead and do the start the NSAIDs first. So the normal painkillers can be used. Oral contraceptive pills have also been seen to be effective, but majorly in case of mild pain. So if the pain is mild, NSAIDs and OCPs can be started initially, right? Now these oral contraceptive pills that are given, they contain estrogen plus progesterone also, and the predominant effect of these oral contraceptive pills is progestational. They have a predominantly progestational effect, and that is why, because of this progesterone component inside the pills, they lead to desidualization or stabilization of these endometriotic deposits, and therefore they relieve pain. The other important thing to note here about this OCP treatment is that they are given continuously. Normally, when a woman takes oral contraceptive pill, she takes for 3 weeks, take a break in between, 1 week off, in which menstrual bleeding takes place. But when we use for treatment of pain in endometriosis, we use it continuously for 3 months. Continuously for 3 to 6 months without giving a break in between. And with this treatment, when we use it continuously, then it will induce amenorrhea. Okay, so we can do that also. All right, so OC pills are going to be used for these very reasons. Another important thing is that when a woman is on oral contraceptive pills, then the pituitary is suppressed, right? When the progesterone effect of the oral contraceptive pills, it causes an inhibition of the pituitary hormones, and that leads to suppression of the ovaries. So when a woman is on oral contraceptive pills, there is suppression of the ovarian production of hormones. And these are the reasons why oral contraceptive pills are helpful in treating the pain of endometriosis, right? One can also use progesterone directly. So one of the other options is that we can use progesterone treatment directly. We can use oral progesterone treatment like medroxyprogesterone acetate. We can also use the Mirena. The Mirena is the levonorgestrel containing intrauterine device, right? So these agents can also be used for treatment of pain. Aromatase inhibitors like letrozole, they will cause the inhibition of androgen conversion into estrogen. So aromatase inhibitors, they decrease the estrogen production and in these deposits, and therefore they are also useful. Okay, and ultimately yes, we can also use GnRH analogues, right? Now these GnRH analogues, which are used to treat the pain for endometriosis, they are going to induce amenorrhea, right? They are going to suppress the ovaries completely, and that is how they are useful in treatment of the pain. And earlier agents like gestrinone and danazole were also used. Again, the concept of treating the pain is the same. We need to suppress the ovarian production of hormones. And these agents, gestrinone and danazole, they are testosterone derivatives. They are acting because they decrease the gonadotropin releasing hormone, and they suppress the hypothalamus and the pituitary production of pituitary hormones, and lead to suppression of the ovaries And that's how they were helpful. But these are agents which are not currently preferred because they have severe androgenic side effects. So they have severe androgenic side effects, so they are not commonly used. What we use commonly is NSAIDs and OCPs for mild pain. We can use progesterone treatment, aromatase inhibitors, and GnRH analogues can also be used, right? And there is a new progesterone in the market as well. There is a new progesterone in the market as well, which is used for the treatment. And that new progesterone, it's not new as in recent 1 or 2 year old new. It is newer in the sense that more and more data is coming up over the last 5 to 6 years about this progesterone. It's very effective. It's Dinogest. So Dinogest in a dose of 2 milligrams daily is a new progesterone which has been seen to be very effective in treatment of endometriosis associated pain. So keep this new drug also in mind for the NEET PG aspirants. All right. Now, I also want to talk a little bit more about GnRH analogues. I want to talk a little bit more about GnRH analogues here. Right. Now, the concept that I will give you here about GnRH analogues applies to all the situations where GnRH analogues are used. Right. Exactly, Subhash, I'm answering your question, how GnRH analogues decrease estrogen. Uja, I'll take up your query also. Any role of MRI? MRI offers no advantage over a routine ultrasound. Okay. So MRI. Again, it's an unnecessary expensive investigation which will offer no advantage over a routine ultrasound. So that's why not usually preferred. Okay. Now, let's talk about GnRH analogues a bit here. Now, what are these GnRH analogues? They are agonists. We have GnRH agonists and we also have GnRH antagonists. Okay. Now, these GnRH agonists, trade name, you can remember the leuprolide is one GnRH agonist. We have another GnRH agonists like the triptorelin, the relin group of drugs, triptorelin and gozarelin and buserelin, right? These are the relins which are the GnRH agonist. And then we have the antagonists which are the relics, right? So we have this cetrirelix, granirelix. Okay, so these are the GnRH antagonists that are there. Now, in the initial part of the sessions, I told you that the GnRH, the naturally occurring GnRH, this naturally occurring GnRH, which is released from the pituitary gland, it is released in a pulsatile manner. Okay, and it is also very short acting. It has a very short half-life. The half-life is only about, on an average, about 3 to 4 minutes. So 3 minutes is the short half-life. So if I tell you that this is the, let's say this is the pituitary, okay, let's say this is the pituitary cell, okay, this is the cell which is the gonadotrope, and this gonadotrope has to release LH and FSH, right? Now the gonadotropes, they have receptors on the cell membrane. This is the GnRH receptor. Okay, which binds to this GnRH, right? Now, in the natural circumstances, the GnRH is secreted in a pulsatile manner. It has a very short half-life. It will come and bind to this receptor, right? The pituitary cell is going to get activated. Release of hormones is going to take place. Because this GnRH has a very short half-life, it will be going to be digested by the body and it is going to leave the receptor. Isn't it? So it is going to come, act on the receptor, leave the receptor, come, act on the receptor, leave the receptor. Isn't it? So that's how there is going to be a stimulatory effect on the gonadotrope in normal circumstances with naturally occurring gonadotropin releasing hormone. But these agonists and antagonists, on the other hand, they have a longer half-life. They have a longer half-life. They have a longer half-life. They are much longer acting, right? So these agonists and antagonists both, they are going to bind to the GnRH receptor. So they come and bind to this GnRH receptor and they stay there. And they stay there, okay? Now what will happen is that they are going to stay there and what it is going to do is it is going to cause receptor desensitization. The prime reason why these agonists and antagonists act is because they cause receptor desensitization. Now, some of you will argue these are agonists. I agree, these are agonists. So agonists will initially cause an increase in gonadotropin production. Cause an increase in gonadotropin because of stimulation of the pituitary. An initial flare, that is called as an initial flare reaction. Okay, but ultimately they are going to cause receptor desensitization because they have occupied the receptors. Now natural occurring GnRH cannot come and occupy those receptors, right? Whereas in the case of antagonists, there is no such flare. All right, and they inhibit the pituitary from the very beginning. All right, so ultimately, eventually, both agonists as well as antagonists are going to cause inhibition of the pituitary. Why? Because they cause receptor desensitization. They come and bind to the receptor, stay there. So the GnRH, normal GnRH, cannot come and act on the receptor. That's not all. They have a very long-term effect. You once give the agonist and antagonist, they are given as monthly injections. They are given as 3 weekly injections. Why? They are long acting. So what do? Once this receptor complex, once this GnRH analog, this is the GnRH analog, whether agonist or antagonist, has bound to the receptor, this complex is going to move inside the cell. Okay, once it moves inside the cell, it is digested by the cellular machinery. It is digested. Okay, and what happens on the cell surface? No receptor. So the receptor and the analog complex, it moves inside the cell, gets digested. Ultimately, there is no receptor left on the pituitary surface, on the gonadotrope surface. Right, so it is going to cause prolonged effects, long standing effects. Right, so ultimately there is going to be eventually inhibition of pituitary. Right, now the utility of these GnRH analogs is in any situation, any condition in gynae. You think of any condition where you want to suppress the ovaries, any condition where you want the ovarian production of hormones to stop. That is why GnRH has been used in endometriosis. It has been used in fibroid uterus also. It has been used in treatment of abnormal uterine bleeding also, right? So it finds many utility in gynae practice because any situation where we need to cause ovarian suppression, and this is long-term ovarian suppression, all right, which occurs with GnRH analogs, right? So we have to give it as 3 weekly or monthly injections leading to ovarian suppression. It is sometimes called as pseudomenopause. However, it's a misnomer, okay? Because in menopause, the FSH and LH hormones are increased, whereas in GnRH analogs, there is inhibition of pituitary, the gonadotropins are decreasing, there is ovarian suppression and ovarian production of hormones is decreasing. So I want you to remember this term here, which I've highlighted. GnRH analogs lead to ovarian suppression, right? And Uja is asking, then how do we use it in hypogonadotropin deficiency? No, we don't. If there's already hypo, these agents lead to hypogonadism. GnRH analogs, they lead to hypogonadism. Okay, they lead to hypogonadism. All right. Now, if Uja, you are wanting to know that how does it lead to these agents can also be used as ovulation induction drugs if short acting agonists are used in a pulsatile manner, then they will act as stimulants. Okay, if short acting agonists are used in a pulsatile manner, low doses of short-acting agonists are given in pulsatile form, then they will lead to stimulation of the pituitary. It is when we give them as long-acting agonist and antagonist that they cause receptor desensitization and leading to finally hypogonadism. Is this mechanism of action clear to you guys? This is a very, very important concept to understand. Wherever we need to achieve ovarian suppression for whatever requirement, we can use these long-acting GnRH analogues. Both agonists and antagonists can be used for this purpose. Agonist initial cause flare, but ultimately are going to cause receptor desensitization only. And antagonists, they will have no initial flare reaction. Okay. Subhash, you want to know, can we use GnRH analogues in all conditions which are estrogen dependent, fibroids, endometrial hyperplasia, endometriosis, adenomyosis? Yes. 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 We can use. But I'll tell you a very big problem that is there with GnRH analogues. Subhash, can you answer that for me? Can you tell me one very big limiting factor why we can't use GnRH analogues for year, 2 year, 3 year, 4 years? Why can't we use GnRH analogues for a long duration of time? Yes. One limitation. They lead to profound ovarian suppression. One of the very important side effects which this GnRH analogues will lead to is osteoporosis, hot flashes, because they cause such severe estrogen deficiency. So they have utility as well as they have side effects, immediate side effects, right? So at one go, we can't use it for more than 6 months. We've used it for 6 months, we'll need to give a break in between, or we'll need to give estrogen from outside in between. Acetonia, the estrogen causes the natural mineralization of bones in women, right? So if you're creating menopause, you can't create menopause in a young woman, in a young reproductive age group woman. So there are serious side effects with GnRH analog which limits its utility also. So we can't keep using them over prolonged periods of time. Alright, so these are the limitations why we cannot use GnRH analogues at a stretch for more than 6 months. If we have to give it for more than 6 months, we'll have to take a break in between and give estrogen in between. That's called as estrogen add back therapy. Okay, clear? So wherever you read GnRH analogues from next time on, this is the mechanism of action by which GnRH analogues find utility. Okay. Now, what are the surgical treatments for endometriosis? Like I told you that we tend to begin, yes, with medical treatment first. But what are the conditions where surgical treatment is going to be done? So what are the indications? Infertility is one of a very valid indication for surgical treatment. A failed medical management of pain, you have tried everything and it's not working now and the woman is bothered with severe pain, then you can go for surgical treatment of endometriosis. What are the methods that are usually employed? It has to be preferably a laparoscopy which is done. Laparoscopic treatment is done. What do we do is that we want to correct the distorted anatomy. So we are going to break those adhesions. We are going to burn those adhesions, cut them up. So free the structures which are stuck together. So that's called as adhesiolysis, right? These deposits, which are the site of that release of inflammatory mediators, those deposits can be burnt by using the cautery instrument. So that's called as fulguration of deposits, right? If the endometriotic cysts are present, what we usually tend to do is that if the cyst is more than or equal to 4 centimeter in size, we remove the cyst. So we go cystectomy. But if there are multiple small cysts, if the cyst size of the cyst is less than 4 centimeter, so 4 centimeter is just this much, right? 4 centimeter is just this much. So if the size of the cyst is so small, the concern is that if we are going to try to remove the cyst, the concern is that maybe we end up damaging the or removing some of the healthy ovary also, some of the healthy ovarian tissue also. So when size is less than 4 centimeter, it is said that just drain the cyst, and after you have drained the cyst, just use fulguration in that area. So if endometriotic cysts are present and the size of the cyst is more than or equal to 4 centimeter, cystectomy is done. If the size is less, then drainage and fulguration of the cyst is done. So these are the commonly employed methods to treat the endometriosis during surgery. And other surgical treatments have also been described, but they are less commonly used. And you'll understand that there is a procedure called as presacral neurectomy. So the presacral section of the nerves that are there, which are transmitting the pain fiber impulses from the peritoneum and from the uterus and the ovaries, they are cut. So this is something that is technically difficult also. All right. So presacral neurectomy is something that has been tried, but it is not widely practiced. And ultimately, yes, hysterectomy and bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy has been reserved for women who are more than 40 years of age, who are severely symptomatic and nothing has worked for them, right? So you can understand that these kind of treatments, they are something that are not commonly employed. All right. And moreover, when we talk about endometriosis, these women are going to be young in the reproductive age who troubled with infertility. So we can't offer hysterectomy and bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy to those women. But yes, if the woman is 40 years of age, more than 40 years of age, if she's completed her family and she's severely symptomatic, don't say that a woman with endometriosis more than 40, let's do total abdominal hysterectomy and bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy. She should be clinically severely symptomatic as well. Other treatments have failed, then only you will resort to. So this is like the last resort. Let me just write one line for this. This is the last resort. Uja, very, very right question. Such a good question. What is the most common cause of recurrence of endometriosis after surgery? The cause of recurrence of endometriosis after surgery is the fact that the ovaries are still inside the woman's body. Plain and simple as that. As long as this woman is having normal functioning ovaries which are synthesizing estrogen, she will be troubled in her lifetime. All these treatment, these medical treatment, these surgical treatments are temporizing treatments. They offer pain relief, yes, but do they cure endometriosis? No. When you do surgery, you do adhesiolysis, you do fulguration, you do remove the cyst. Does that mean they cannot occur again? No, they can occur again because she has healthy functioning ovaries, right? The ovaries are going to produce estrogen again and these deposits can form again. So that's the reason. The ultimate cure for endometriosis would be, let's say, after menopause when the ovaries have suppressed. Maybe then she will be relieved of endometriosis, only then. All right? So yes, endometriosis is a chronic condition which affects women in ways more than one, can be mild, can be severe, spectrum is there, all right? If it is severe, it leads to severe consequences, severity of pain increases, the chances of having infertility also increases, right? There is no 100% cure of this condition. Woman lives with it. All right, we can only try to give her relief of symptoms. We can only try to help her with her fertility. And we can only try to prevent them from flaring too much. We can only slow down the progression of endometriosis and not eliminate it altogether. Okay, so we can't clear the pelvis absolutely. We can just slow down the progression of endometriosis. Okay. Now let's take up a few clinical questions and they will help you see how these women presents and what can be done for them. So there's a 28-year-old married woman who complains of inability to conceive for the past 2 years. So she's suffering from infertility for 2 years. She also complains of severe dysmenorrhea. The pain starts a few days before menses and persists throughout menses. She also complains of painful intercourse. Her menstrual cycles are regular. On pelvic examination, the uterus is normal size, fixed retroverted, and there is tenderness in the posterior vaginal fornix. So yes, a basic transvaginal sonography was done 6 months ago. It has already been done and that's normal. Nothing showed on the transvaginal sonography, which I told you is quite possible with minimal or mild endometriosis, and when the deposits are small, they might not be clinically visible on transvaginal sonography. All right, so what is the next step in management? A diagnostic laparoscopy, hysterosalpingography, MRI pelvis, or hysteroscopy. I told you that MRI pelvis offers no advantage, additional advantage over a transvaginal sonography. Hysterosalpingography shows the insides of the uterus and the tubes. I want to see the pelvis. Hysteroscopy also shows the insides of the uterus. I want to see the pelvis. And the gold standard is diagnostic laparoscopy. So rightly said, Rashmi and Vishnu, the diagnosis here is going to be made by performing a diagnostic laparoscopy. Once we do a diagnostic laparoscopy, and if we find something, we can also treat it at the same time. We can also treat it in the same setting. In fact, we should treat it in the same setting. I mean, there should not be a diagnostic laparoscopy first and then make up your mind and then talk about operative laparoscopy the next time. That will increase your hospital cost. You are increasing hospital admission. You're also making her pay for anesthesia twice and hospital stay twice. So obviously a diagnostic and a therapeutic laparoscopy can be done in the same sitting, right? So that makes sense. All right. Now, let's move on to the next question here. See how the clinical profile changes and see how the investigative choice will change. A 25-year-old unmarried woman complains of severe dysmenorrhea for the past 2 years that has been gradually progressive. The pain starts a few days before menses, persists throughout menses. She also complains of painful intercourse. On pelvic examination, the uterus is normal size, but there is bilateral adnexal tenderness. Now, what is the next step in management? Uja, you're asking, can peritoneal endometriosis recur after THBSO? Yes, it can. Even after THBSO, it can recur. But it is unlikely because the ovaries have been removed. Okay. Dr. Musarrat, you want to know initial therapy is NSAIDs or OCPs depending upon the severity of pain. Okay, so you can try NSAIDs, but NSAIDs also have been seen to be less effective than OCPs. And NSAIDs can be used if there is only dysmenorrhea and not chronic pelvic pain. So if a woman is having only painful periods, then NSAIDs during the time of periods can be tried. But if she has pain for the whole month, then you would like to prefer to give oral contraceptive pills rather than give NSAIDs for the whole month on a daily basis. Right? Make sense? All right. Now let's take up this question. What is the next step in the management? So most of you are saying yes, option number C, transvaginal sonography. So right now she does not have infertility. Right now she's a young girl, right? Why do you want to go for a diagnostic laparoscopy to make the diagnosis, right? On pelvic examination, the uterus is normal. There's just bilateral adnexal tenderness. So you can go for the next step, that is transvaginal sonography. So in this situation, do not say diagnostic laparoscopy as the answer. That will be too extreme a procedure because diagnostic laparoscopy will require hospital admission, will require anesthesia. It's a surgical procedure. So let us begin with a transvaginal sonography in this young woman, right? Now, what if the transvaginal sonography is normal? What if the transvaginal sonography is normal? Answer this. What if the transvaginal sonography is normal in this particular case? Should I start treating her dysmenorrhea or should I say, no, let's do a diagnostic laparoscopy first and then I will confirm and then I will treat your dysmenorrhea? Her main complaint is dysmenorrhea. Right? Some painful intercourse is there. Even if the transvaginal sonography is normal, can I start empirical treatment straight away? Yes or no? Can I start empirical medical treatment straight away without resorting to a diagnostic laparoscopy and confirming the diagnosis? Yes or no? I'm waiting for a yes or no answer. Yes, I am getting yes. Uja is saying yes. pain management, Shubhas is saying yes. Yes, very good. I do not need to unnecessarily make this young woman undergo a diagnostic laparoscopy if the transvaginal sonography is absolutely normal, nothing significant is found. In this clinical profile, I can start the empirical medical treatment for pain straight away. Okay, now let's see the next question. There's a 30-year-old woman with two children who complains of dysmenorrhea. TVS shows a thin-walled left-sided ovarian cyst of size 3 cm with echogenic fluid. So dysmenorrhea, ovarian cyst 3 cm with echogenic fluid. She does not wish to conceive. What is the first line of management? Laparoscopic cystectomy, treat with OCPs, treat with GnRH analogues or oral progesterone treatment. What is the first line of management? She only complains of dysmenorrhea. Okay, and on ultrasound, there is a small cyst with echogenic fluid. This could be a normal a follicular ovarian cyst also. This could be an endometriotic cyst also. There is dysmenorrhea, so I think that it might be an endometriotic cyst. But whatever it is, she does not wish to conceive right now. And her complaint is pain. So right now, we can do what? Subhash and Uja are saying laparoscopic cystectomy. Rashmi and Chaudhary are saying treat with GnRH analogues. Okay. Musarat is saying OCP is maramizole. So I've got all three options. None of you says progesterone treatment. Fine. She does not wish to conceive. Laparoscopic cystectomy is a surgical procedure, right? And I told you that cystectomy is done when a cyst is more than 4 cm. And the primary indication of a surgery is when the medical treatment fails, right? Why can't we treat her OCPs? Why can't we treat her with oral contraceptive pills? That will relieve her dysmenorrhea. That will also provide her contraception. Right? Her complaint is not of infertility. She's 30 years old. She already has two children. Right? So why do we want to go ahead with an invasive procedure? And why do you want to treat with GnRH analogues? These will come lower down in your list. Let's try OCPs first. If they don't work, maybe then I would start thinking of GnRH analogues. Why right now? She's not having a severe chronic pelvic pain which bothers her for the entire month. She's having dysmenorrhea. It can resolve with giving oral contraceptive pills as well, isn't it? So treat with OCPs first, try that treatment first, rather than resorting to all these methods. With GnRH analogues, again, the problem is that you can't give it for more than 6 months and it leads to side effects, osteoporosis and hot flashes, woman will have backache. She will say, I had one problem, you had given me another problem, right? So let's try with the lesser invasive methods first. Let's try with the simpler methods first. They can, OCPs by themselves can also relieve the dysmenorrhea. They will also provide contraception and then she will be relieved. Then she doesn't need to go through this invasive surgical procedure and the risk of anesthesia with that or the treatment of GnRH analogues, right? Now let's see this question. There's a 30-year-old, now let's look at this, how the clinical profile changes. There's a 30-year-old, but this time she's nulliparous, who's complaining of severe congestive dysmenorrhea. Now she has an ovarian cyst of 5 cm, left-sided ovarian cyst of 5 cm with echogenic fluid. And she has also been trying to conceive for the past 1 year. Look how her profile changed. It still looks like endometriosis. Right? She has been trying to conceive for the past 1 year. She has not been successful. Now what will be the first line of management? Now it will be a laparoscopic cystectomy. So if there is a woman with infertility, and you suspect endometriosis, you should go for laparoscopy. All right. Even if there's a cyst or no cyst. If there's a cyst, you do a cystectomy. If there is no cyst, whatever you find inside the pelvis, we go for a radiculosis. right? So if there's a woman with infertility and endometriosis is suspected, one should prefer to go for a laparoscopy as the next line in management. Okay, clear? And the other important thing is that I want to point out here, which we did not discuss here, what was the treatment of infertility? What was the treatment of infertility per se? So we have done the surgical management of endometriosis. We've done the laparoscopic adhesiolysis and whatever was required. Okay, we can do that. And what will we do after that? Should we tell the woman that, okay, go ahead, you are treated, conceive. Right? Then what do we do? How do we treat this infertility? Most of the times, these women will have difficulty conceiving spontaneously on their own, even after when we have done the laparoscopic surgery. So most of the time, these women, we need to go for ovulation induction. We need to go for maybe ovulation induction and intrauterine insemination or IVF even. So fertility treatment or infertility treatment of endometriosis is going to be along those lines. We treat the endometriosis and then we start supporting them in their efforts in achieving a pregnancy. All right. IVF, yes, ultimately, yes, but we can start with ovulation induction, IUI, and then maybe reach IVF ultimately. So that will we have to do. Subhash, you're saying that if the size is less than 4, then the answer is cystectomy. If the size is less than 4, then the answer is drainage and fulguration of the cyst. Okay, if the size is less than 4, then the answer is drainage and fulguration of the cyst, again done laparoscopically. Yes, Mariam, whatever drug that we use for ovulation induction, clomiphene or letrozole or GnRH analog are also used in the ovulation induction protocol for IVF. So that is something that is a completely different set of discussion altogether. But she does enter into that whole cycle of fertility treatment, which begins with various drugs used for ovulation induction. Then if that fails, then maybe ovulation induction and intrauterine insemination. If that works fine, then otherwise we try IVF. So that is, it is the step ladder approach. Try something less invasive, then try something else, then try something else. All right. Uja, criteria for IUI, IVF, infertility for 1 year. I'll take an entire separate session for that. Okay, Uja. All right. Let us first talk about infertility and its causes, right? How to evaluate for that infertility. And then finally, I will talk about the criteria for IUI, IVF, infertility. Right, because a lot of you will need to have an understanding with the basic concepts of infertility first to be able to understand why IUI, why IVF, why not one or the other. So let's go in a systematic approach, and those are the lectures that I have planned for you in the coming sessions. All right, so I'm going to talk about that in the upcoming sessions. All right, so first I'll talk about the evaluations of infertility and then we'll talk about the treatment later. All right, so that's been my time, guys. Thank you, friends. And a plus course is ongoing on the plus platform, which is a capsule course on high risk pregnancy. And it had started on 21st August. It is still ongoing. Today, I'm going to be taking a session on heart disease and pregnancy with previous cesarean section. If you want to join in, you can join me there on the Unacademy platform. And you can use the code SHONALI to subscribe to the platform and get a 10% discount. All right. So have a good day. And thank you so much for the support and thank you so much for listening. Yes, Uja, tomorrow's topic is going to be fertility, understanding fertility and the causes of infertility. I will talk about that tomorrow. Okay, thank you so much.